Welcome everybody. It's great to see you all here for our University of South Australia Nelson Mandela lecture. We jointly present this with the School of Law and are very proud to do so. Nelson Mandela is the patron of the Hawke Centre, the international patron. He is a man who stands for international justice. He is also an honorary doctor of the University of South Australia, hence our connection through this lecture with him. I'd like to begin by first of all acknowledging the Kaurna people on whose land we meet. We are in the place of the red kangaroo dreaming. We've had great support from Kaurna elders in creating our gallery, and we thank them and we pay respects, our respects to the elders and to all peoples who identify with the land and the 60,000 years of Aboriginal heritage in this place. As the director of the Hawke Centre, my name is Liz Ho, for those who don't know me. We are very proud to ensure that new ideas and thinking are available to our community. We take very seriously the Mandela statement that education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. And the stated purpose of this lecture is to promote the fundamental rights and freedoms of individuals and the value of truth and reconciliation in life and public affairs. So it's quite a lot to live up to, but we're sure that we're going to do that tonight. The session is being recorded. There will be a podcast of the event available on our website later next week. We encourage you to bring this to the attention of friends and colleagues who couldn't be here tonight. And we'd also be very grateful if you could turn off your mobile phones so we don't get an interruption to our recording. Our distinguished speaker will address you for 50 minutes, after which there will be a short question time. I note our question policy. We ask for questions, not long statements. And this, of course, means that more people can participate. We have an audience that is wonderfully diverse and from professions covering architecture, law, human rights, international relations, and students of those fields of interest, and many others who regularly support our program. I thank you all for attending and have time to acknowledge a few special guests. Our speaker, Professor Eyal Weizman, who will be introduced more fully in a minute. Professor Peter Hoy, our Vice-Chancellor and President of our university, who regrettably leaves us at the end of this week, so this will be one of his last official duties, and we're very, very pleased to have him here tonight. We have Louise Smith, State Director of Department of Immigration and Citizenship, and Alex Brooking, State Director of Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade with us. Professor Palaluwalia, Pro Vice-Chancellor. Professor Roman Tomasik, Dean of the School of Law, Alan Balafi, President of the Australia-Israel Chamber of Commerce, Brenton Ronenberg, Chairman of the Australian Arab Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and David Denborough, who is the Chairperson of the Dulwich Centre Foundation, which is dedicating to serving victims of trauma. We also have representatives of the Friends of Palestine and also of the United Nations Association. I'd now like to invite Professor Palaluwalia, our Pro Vice-Chancellor, to formally introduce our speaker, whom he happens to know very well. Thank you.
Thanks, Liz. It's always a pleasure to introduce a speaker, but in this particular case, it's an absolute delight. As Liz said, I've known Eyal now for I reckon more than a decade. And I'll just share quickly a very close bond that we formed. Although I do hate him, he had a chair when he was 34, so I hate people like that, but anyway. So the first time I met Eyal, and he usually does this, he sort of flies in for 30 seconds and flies out. And he did the same thing. I flew in from London, he flew in, I think, from Israel at that particular time to Singapore. And he gave this absolutely brilliant paper. And we just hit it off immediately. So came back and said to people at Goldsmiths, we've got to have this guy. He's just, you know, he's the next big thing. But of course, little did I know that people were already talking to him. And you know, but it was one of the most amazing things to meet Eyal, and over the years to forge a friendship. I might just say before I formally introduce him that he's been a bit cheap. We flew him all out and he didn't even bring me a copy of his new book, which I'm told, as you know, I've just bought it outside. He will be available to sign copies later. And that's the only other plug I'll give you. All right. So Eyal Weizman is an architect, and a very good one, because I often visited his squatting house that he somehow got and converted into this amazing place on Brick Lane. He's an architect, a professor of visual cultures, and director of the Center for Research Architecture at Goldsmiths at the University of London. And since 2011, he also directs the European Research Council-funded project Forensic Architecture, of which he will be saying a lot more tonight, on the place of architecture in international humanitarian law. Since 2007, he is a founding member of the architectural collective DAR in Bit Sohar, Palestine, and Eyal has been a professor of architecture, as I said, at the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna, which is when I first met him. And also has taught at Bartlett, at the UCL in London, and the Stadel School in Frankfurt. He lectured, curated, and organized conferences in many institutions worldwide, and having attended a couple of those, they're always fantastic. His books include The Least of All Possible Evils, one of the books that's available outside today, Hollow Land, A Civilian Occupation, the series Territories 1, 2, 3, Yellow Rhythms, and many articles in journals, magazines, and edited books. Weizman, indeed, is a regular contributor and an editorial board member of several journals and magazines, including Humanity, Cabinet, and Inflections. He's worked with a variety of NGOs worldwide and was a member of the Betzalim Board of Directors. He's currently on the advisory boards of the ICA in London, the Human Rights Project at Bard in New York, and other academic and cultural institutions. Weizman is a recipient of the James Sterling Memorial Lecture Prize for 2006-2007, a co-recipient of the 2010 Prince Claus Prize for Architecture, and has delivered the Rusty Bernstein, Paul Hurst, and of course Edward Said Memorial Lectures, amongst others. He studied architecture at the Architectural Association London and completed his PhD with Paul Hurst at the London Consortium and Birkbeck College. So please, I extend a warm welcome to Eyal Weizman.
Wow, this is so wonderful. Thanks, Paul. That's great. What a great introduction, Paul. Thank you very much. You know, and I just have to say that I met Paul at Goldsmiths, or, you know, we met before, but then at Goldsmiths, and really one of our great losses has been that he's come here. So I think that you can consider yourself incredibly lucky to have him, and especially in the position that he has here. I also would like to thank Elizabeth Ho, who was here before presenting. Ah, here you are. Yes, of course. Then thank you for the organization. And to Louise Carnell, who also coordinated that. I'm particularly happy to be here to speak in the context of the Bob Hawke Nelson Mandela lecture, because I feel a certain affinity with the mission statement, broadly speaking. Architecture, much like the intertwined aims of the Bob Hawke, you know, the career and work of Nelson Mandela, and the UNESCO chair, and kind of the UNESCO event that also we've been in today, could indeed be necessary to create sustainable society for a peaceful world. architecture could also be the mean to achieve justice and reconciliation. We can see that in some of the projects in South Africa that are building kind of new institutional framework and a new society there. This might have been the reason for the organizers to have invited an architect to give this 2012 Mandela lecture, although I suspect that it was more to do with my engagement with the darker side of architecture that attracted their attention. As with the architecture of apartheid, and to a certain extent, Israel occupation in the West Bank, architecture could be used as a mean of separation, repression, and incarceration and segregation. Architecture is thus political in more than one way. It could be used for repression on the one hand, and it could be used for liberation on the other. It is a technology, and as a technology, it is defined by the context of its use. There's nothing inherently repressive or inherently liberative in the organization of space. It's purely bound to the way it is exercised and to the political context in which it is used. Sometimes the same building, and today in the UNESCO lecture I showed an exhibition ground in Belgrade that has turned into a concentration death camp during the Nazi occupation, later turned into a Roma village, and now turning into a museum. The same building, the same architectural arrangement can do those multiple things. Whatever it is that architecture does, it is political. And this in as much as it is the materialization of political forces. Through architecture, abstract forces, or the multivalented force field of political, economical, and military forces are slowing into form, right? Form is simply the kind of slowing down of forces, never fully static. There is nothing like temporary or permanent architecture. Architecture is always in movement. It's always politics turning into form. And this is, or it is a certain acceleration of matter, as in a kind of a blast energy, as I will show you also later. If architecture is thus political, then looking at architecture, the organization of our built environment, as I've done during the past decades, can allow one to unpack and sketch out something of the political forces that are fossilized into its organization and form. My question in this talk is thus how to invert the act of architecture, somehow turn time backwards, as we create not ever new forms from social or political forces, but rather harvest forces that are locked within form, right? So we look at form and we, as an entry point into politics, and our way of intervening in politics as architects is through offering ever new and more nuanced reading of material form, right? The unlocking forces from form. I understand that in this audience is composed of, besides many interested and distinguished guests, also a large constituency of law and architecture students. So I will try to bring the insight somehow by combining insight from those two disciplines. Of course, my home is in architecture, but increasingly I work now with lawyers, with international lawyers and human rights lawyers, in kind of trying to understand the place of law or the kind of the intersection of architecture and the laws of war. I will explain, but let's start with an example. This is what is increasingly called the pyramids of Gaza, right? Not the pyramids of Giza, the pyramids of Gaza. In fact, there is it's a form that is now becoming very current throughout the Gaza Strip. It's a form of destruction that hasn't been previously seen. What generates that particular morphology of destruction? In fact, it is a combination between two typical things to the Gaza Strip right now. On the one hand, a three-story building typical of the houses, the homes of refugees, and a D9 Caterpillar bulldozer. The way a bulldozer destroys a building is that its short shovel can only reach and topple the peripheral columns of a building. The central column remain intact. The top slab break along the approximate center, leading to a progressive collapse and the form of a pyramid, right? So what can we learn from seeing those pyramids? Can we only look at and understand that as a meeting of two typical typologies to the Gaza Strip? Or can we connect that into a kind of a much larger political and legal framework? What are the frames of forensic architecture? In fact, in the last major Israeli attack on Gaza, in the winter of 2008-2009, about 15,000 buildings have been either completely destroyed or damaged, right? This is about 15% of the buildings in the Gaza Strip. We also know that about 1,400 people died, mainly civilians. And we also know that most people that died in Gaza died within buildings. And of those, most people died within their own homes. So we can no longer look at architecture simply as the location of war. War does not happen in the city, in as much as there is violence within that particular environment, but by the city. The death occurs by people being crushed by bits of their homes flying at them at high speed, right? The minute that destruction ended, the way architecture actually those forms became evidence, right? So initially they become means of destruction. After the war, immediately they became evidence, but for very different contexts. Look at this is, of course, one more of these imperfect pyramids of Gaza, and you see a serial number on it. North, meaning the north of the Gaza Strip, and a certain grid line number. You see it on every bit of destroyed building in Gaza. There's tattooed, there is this one. This is from Rafah. You see tattooed the serial number. Every building in Gaza, destroyed or built, has been designated a number. And this is by the Ministry of Construction and Housing. Imagine, a Ministry of Construction and Housing of Gaza right now, run by the Hamas government of that place, without the ability to rebuild the street, with the siege still choking, building material going into there, the only thing that they can do is to classify and to create that kind of archives of destruction within that. On the other hand, we have the international investigation here, very well known, Justice Goldstone, who authored the Goldstone Report, and in fact, for the first time, shifted somehow the epistemology of war crime investigation from a reliance on testimony to a reliance on rubble, on ruin, the analysis of ruins. I will go back to that. This is the person that is, in fact, undertaken most of the analysis for Goldstone. You would see a certain transformation occurring. Human rights and international humanitarian law, this is something I will go back to again and again in this lecture, are usually constructed around witness testimony. In fact, the testimony of survivors has been almost the raison d'etre of human rights. Human rights is about the individual voice against a certain kind of idea of a repressive or totalitarian state. We can see a certain transformation occurring. Not here, I will show the historical development of that. As a human right person, you take a photograph, usually, of the people, and here a woman sitting very steadfast, admirably steadfast in front of the ruin of her home. But in the presentation of evidence, what is important in this picture is not the person, but rather the rubble, the trash and rubble that could be seen behind. Again, that archive of the ministry in Gaza that does not try to claim the same thing that the Goldstone report tried to claim, war crimes in Gaza, but something else. Something else is now spoken on behalf of those ruins. The destruction in Gaza is seen by that government there as the destruction of destruction. Destruction of refugee camps. Refugee camps already designate the destruction of Palestine in 1948. The destruction of the camps are seen in very political sense as the destruction of destruction. What would that mean? And this is bits from the archive of what is called the Book of Destruction that the government of Hamas is collecting with each house within it, 15,000 entries. So this is where our project, Forensic Architecture, enters. To think both the place of architectural evidence in international humanitarian law, we know very well that most war now happen in cities, whether it is in Gaza, or in Baghdad, or in Kabul, or in many other urban environment, most conflict happen in cities. Because conflict happen in cities, militaries are kind of engaged in studying architecture to a certain extent, or understanding urbanism. Because war happen in cities, it is also registered on the architecture of that city, and architecture become evidence. So we see in many of international forums, this is an archive collected by Susan Shupley of architectural evidence in the ICTY, the court of that looks at war crime in former Yugoslavia, and increasingly in other places. In fact, architectural evidence emerges out of the intersection of two technologies right now. One is satellite imagery. More and more, the decreased capacity of human rights people to enter the places of violence mean that there is an increased reliance on satellite imagery. On the other hand, what comes from, what arrives from this region are activist videos and activist photographs. So between those two types of evidence, our understanding of conflict as kind of a transformation in space are constructed. Very much we see catastrophe right now, or the kind of the results of war in before and after images. Of course, satellite have a kind of a rhythm as they're orbiting the globe. They never capture the event itself. Therefore, capturing before and after images designate that kind of event which is always missing within that. The kind of the event on the ground is replaced by an architectural event. How do we know, or debates about whether there was or whether wasn't there genocide in Darfur is undertaken by analyzing satellite images of architecture. We know how many people, or those human rights people that do this analysis, know how many people on average live within those compounds. They would count destroyed compounds, multiply it, and get that particular number. But also in our own kind of newspapers, we see increasingly images, before and after images, as an entry point to understanding political or scientific process. So how often do we see before and after photographs of Iran right now? No? Can we tell that Iran is developing or not nuclear capacity by looking at the amount of sort of earth that is being excavated somewhere in the eastern Irani desert, right? What we are engaging in increasingly is a certain archaeology of the present, by which architecture and its destruction and construction, the transformation of built matter across the environment, is seen as an entry point for political and military decisions, right? who destroyed that military base in Iran, etc., etc. This is a kind of contemporary archaeology. It's not an archaeology of matter. Nobody is there to go and measure and excavate. It's an archaeology of pixels, an archaeology of wavelengths, an archaeology that excavate the reality as it is captured by different forms of media. Now, I think that I mentioned a certain transformation in human rights work from what is generally referred to by academics writing about the histories of violence as the era of the witness to a certain shift in emphasis towards science and objectivity. And I think that very much that kind of shift in emphasis occurs around a particular trial, and that is the trial of the Argentine junta in the middle of the 80s, after the Falkland War and the demise of the military regime there, where in fact, in the context of international justice, for the first time, we have scientific evidence presented by experts. This man here, his name is Clyde Snow, in fact, one of the great gravediggers of the 20th century. A man who has identified the bodies both of Tutankhamun, King Tutankhamun, of JFK, and of Joseph Mengele, as I would show you later. Here standing, presenting the skull of one of the victims of the repressions in Argentina, a disappeared person called Liliana Pereira, to an international, or sorry, a forum, a kind of an Argentinian court operating according to international law, principles of international law. And I think that presents a certain triangle that could help me explain the way in which I understand what forensics is. Because, you know, we need to explain both words somehow in forensic architecture, right? I mean, we need to kind of somehow shift their meaning from the kind of like the received understanding. Forensics, in fact, coming from the Latin forensis, is the art of the forum. The word forensics comes from forum. In fact, originally, it's not a feature of law at all. It's a feature of rhetoric. And rhetoric is about speech. But forensics is not only about the speech of humans, it's about the speech of things, right? So it includes the way in which things speak to a forum. But because things do not speak, at least they don't speak in the language of humans, we need an interpreter. The interpreter in those Roman times were the orators, exercising something that Quintilian called prosopopeia, right? It's kind of a rhetorical feature by which things, objects, are endowed with a voice. So then it was the rhetorician, today it's the expert scientist. So in order to have a forensic moment, we need a relationship between, or relation between three things: the object that is called to speak, the interpreter, and the forum. And that relation is continuously shifting, right? Sometimes the forums are not existing. Sometimes they assemble around the problem of interpreting particular objects. In here, I've shown you this image before. In fact, I think in a kind of perverse way, you see in that image microphones put in front of that building. But the person that kind of interpret that building to the international forum is here, Goldstone. So we have a kind of a perfect forensic photograph that includes those three, this kind of triangulated relation. When I went to interview this great gravedigger called Clyde Snow about his work, he has in fact sent me to that kind of moment on which I've written an entire book. Paul, you mentioned it, a book called Mengele Skull, The Advent of Forensic Aesthetics. In fact, it wasn't the Argentinian trial. It was an exhumation of one body that was still unidentified. And the problem of its exhumation, the body that was assumed to be that of Mengele, few months before the Argentinian trial, provided the entire technology and shifted that kind of attention to material. So this is the moment where the chief of the Brazilian police puts his hand into the grave, assumed to be that of Mengele, pulls out a skull and says, the hunt is over. Of course, that was a contested claim that had to be substantiated. Something occurred there. Scientists from all over the world, pathologists and grave diggers, arrived in Brazil into the morgue of this little town next to Sao Paulo called Embu des Artes in order to study that skeleton. And as it happens, when you have a group of great minds and a lot of enough budget for it, they come up with a new science. That was called by this, by Clyde Snow here, explaining that on the slide, osteobiography, a biography of a bone. A bone is also an object. How can it have a biography? In fact, that process of fossilization, right, literally, the way in which a life story, a lifeline, is inscribed within the bone. The bone is a very dynamic, although it appears to be a kind of a hard object, it is responsive to many things. It is responsive to your migration, say, from Central Europe to Central America, if you are Mengele, in the middle of the, or in the early 50s. That is something that is registered on the bone. Also, every habit, labor, type of work that you were doing, and illnesses, of course. That is osteobiography. As an architect, it's incredibly interesting for me because it's about the way in which process, a life process, turns into form. And you can read that life back from the bone in order to corroborate and say whether the bone that you have discovered belongs to a person whose life narrative is similar to the one that you think you have found. And various other photographic techniques that you can read in the book on Mengele that I have described, by which somehow the kind of subject and object are kind of combined in that idea, a projection of a photograph onto a skull, life onto death. And I absolutely love that image of the press conference because it shows you quite clearly that the person or the thing giving that address is actually the skull. So this is this man, and he said, why are you in fact interested in all these old stories? And I said, well, you know, I'm researching that thing called forensic architecture. I'm trying to understand what it is. And he said, he's a Texan, kind of, in fact, one of those incredible sort of other type of human rights activist, let's say, that come very much from the right, from the American kind of libertarian right. No? So he's like, want to hear nothing of the state. And he's going like, I've got work for you in Guatemala. And this is now the Guatemala, in fact, out of his practice, many groups of were conducting exhumation after the Mengele investigation after the Argentinian trials, we went to Guatemala to participate in one of the largest worldwide forensic processes that try to recreate and understand, in fact, the process of one of the features of the Guatemalan Civil War, the destruction of the Ixchil Maya in the Quiche Mountain, just north of Guatemala City, again, in the 80s. So 150 grave diggers walking up the jungle to kind of discover both the mass graves and the remains of the villages that were there. What they needed for me, in fact, was just somebody to understand the architectural, the spatial logic of that conflict. This is just part of the Clyde Snow Laboratory in Guatemala. Of course, a lot of the osteobiography that I like as an architect in its relation of materiality, the relation between materiality and process, now replaced by DNA labs. And this is the Clyde Snow DNA lab. But there is something very spatial about those things. So this is a model of what happens when you look for mass graves using airplanes going on above areas suspected of having mass graves, and actually measuring the topography of the ground, right? They're looking algorithmically, computers are looking for little disturbances in the surface, moments where the actual topography does not represent the natural way in which air and water move on rock, right? So little disturbances in that indicate a disturbed ground, no? So what you see here is a very technical kind of print of something which is horrific. This is a mass grave. And you can see the edges of it where it sags. You can see the swelling in the middle. But you know, these are minute differences in territories that you can actually kind of undertake. Based on these kind of technologies and other attempts, we were going into the rainforest in Guatemala trying to look for the remains of 500 villages. Sometimes you need to follow fruit trees. You know, in one place there is many more higher concentration of avocado tree. You know, anyone that studied Palestine, you know that you can find the villages that were destroyed in 48 by cacti and other plants. Also in Guatemala, you go into a place and you kind of uncover the sort of the basements of those buildings. Of course, even though they were destroyed in the 80s, the forests accelerate the process of architectural destruction. These villages were constructed mainly out of natural material that were biodegradable and just became jungle again, so to say. What remains is only on the surface. You need to be very, very tuned to the surface itself as you kind of cut it and discover the remains of buildings. I'll actually run through it. We've mapped that entire campaign in the Ixchil area in order to understand the process of the destruction of the Ixchil Maya in that area, not simply as a kind of a series of massacres that we know have occurred, but as a complete reorganization of the natural and built environment. The fields that were common fields that were belonging to communities rather than to individuals or families were fenced up and ordered. A lot of the forest, what you see here are the areas of deforestation within this area and here you can see the in blue, this is kind of deforested part, and you can see the massive deforestation that occurs part of the campaign for the destruction of those people. A complete reorganization also of collecting all those points, all those villages into major regional centers where people could be controlled, supervised, and their life, the form of life, transformed. But here is another one of these forensic moments, no? When you have the forum assembling around the evidence. This is why I'm thinking that forensic architecture is not only about the past. It's not only about uncovering the way in which the past process is sort of fossilized into spatial form, but about creating forums which are, in fact, our modes of political organization. And this could be ad hoc in that kind of religious, scientific kind of moment that is happening here. Or it could be in many other forms. Even you can say that the courts for Yugoslavia has been assembled around the evidence. It's not, you know, in criminal law, you have the forum, then you have different type of crimes that are being brought in front of existing forums. In international law, the evidence itself precedes the forum. And I think that the creation of different forums, continuous creation of different forums, is also the task of forensic architecture. It's a projective task. So I was talking about that surface of the earth, about that way in which the surface of the earth become informationally enriched through various sensors, through various technologies of its mapping, understanding the way histories, very complex histories, that are made by multiple players. Of course, international humanitarian law, or the laws of war, are somehow more complex to render judgment upon than criminal law. Why? Because they're produced by multiplicity of actors in their kind of interaction, military, civilian, contractual, and others, right? There's ideological reasons. They are a kind of, the facts of those crime are produced by a much more wide kind of interaction of players. This is what I have called in my previous work the political plastic. Right? This is just a section of this map. This is a map I've drawn of the West Bank in 2002 in order to show, in a kind of forensic architectural way, how the building of the colonies, Israeli colonies in the West Bank, are bisecting and interrupting Palestinian regional structures. How crimes are actually undertaken on the drawing boards of architects or on screens of design software. How the actual organization of the blue here that you see in the map, the Israeli colonies, are bisecting, creating wedges that interrupt Palestinian built fabric. But if we abstract these forms for 1 second from their immediate context, you understand something, or I think you can follow me in understanding something that I call the political plastic. Architecture is the political plastic in as much as political forces are continuously folded into form, right? In order to make justice to that relation, I would have to be able to press play on that map, and you would see how every political or geopolitical realignment is registered in the shifting relations between the stain of color on this map. Here, the Israeli colonies, the Palestinian areas, and Palestinian-built fabric, right? So every turn and twist, every detail of form can be read backwards to understand the forces that have produced it. So we look at architecture never as a static thing, as constantly dynamic and evolving, constantly translating political forces into form. But then you would say to me that the wall in the West Bank is in fact the opposite of what I'm saying. It is the embodiment of a top-down political decision that separates Israelis and Palestinians in the West Bank. But in fact, what I would like to show you is how that the wall is actually effective through its continuous transformation, right? So we're looking now at another forensic architectural moment, and this is now the trial of the wall, for which I have also provided some evidence, in the Israeli High Court of Justice in 2004, I think. So this is basically expropriation orders that are thrown in Palestinian fields. Between those two red lines, or within that form, these are the area to be annexed. What you see here is, in fact, the introduction of physical architectural planning evidence into the court. You see the military here hanging their maps. You see the human rights group, Mohammed Dakhle, the lawyer, setting up slides to provide as evidence in the court. But of course, judges like anyone else, cannot read architectural maps and plans. They did not understand what are the material facts of the argument. The human rights group was there to claim, not against the wall, but for the disproportionality of the wall, right? That the wall disproportionately infringes on human rights of the people living in the same area. So they had to show slopes and valleys and orchards, etc. And at some point, the judges say, "Genug, we don't understand anything," you know. And just like an architectural teacher tells her or his students that are speaking too much, go home and build a model. So the judge suspend the court and send both parties to go and construct models and to bring them to court. In fact, the human rights team, not knowing who and how to build models, they're not architects or planners, go to a military contractor that build simulation for the military to build their model. And the very first model of the wall was built not by the people that were erecting the wall, but by people that were opposing it, right? This is a kind of a paradox here. Now, if you're as nerd to kind of architectural evidence that as I am, you would see a kind of a funny moment within that model. So here, this is the green line. It separates, this is what is internationally accepted as State of Israel, and this is the occupied territories, right? So areas occupied in 48, areas occupied in 67, international recognized border. This is the wall, as was built by military contractors. And this is what the human rights people called the lesser evil wall. Still a wall, but not as invasive as the red one. Now, but if you look at one point, the lesser evil wall crosses the international border into Israel proper and then back out. Why? In order for it not, for them not to be considered as if they have proposed a part of the wall. Of course, they knew that Israel would never build the wall in its own territory. After the 10 days, the model is being built. The porters bring the model in, and they're walking round and round in circle because nobody has actually fixed in the High Court of Justice place for the display of models. The High Court is normally not looking at evidence, only at process. So they walk round and round in circles. Nobody knows where to put it. Somebody has an idea. It's, you know, it's kind of like Mediterranean mess. Bring a table from the cafeteria. Somebody's rushing to the cafeteria. They put the table in front of the justice bench and the model on it. But the judges are sitting too high and the model is too low. And in fact, they cannot see it. So I'm sure you say the same. I see there is a judge here. We say in Israel, judges have no legs, no? Or they can sit with, underwear or in flip-flops behind their, what it's called, the bench, right? But for the very first time, of course, I cannot photograph it. It's in process. They have all went down and stand around the model. So another kind of forum is created that interrupted the legal process. No longer anyone is saying, "Your Honor," or "My learned friend," or whatever lawyers say to judges, and judges say to themselves, and lawyers say to themselves. But there's a kind of interruption. The material language of architecture and planning replaces the legal language of negotiations. And in fact, like kids, everybody likes models, no? I mean, models are like reduced world under control. And they are kind of, and also, you know, with the kind of Israeli lawyers there, it kind of brings back memories of being in the army, and everybody just like jump on the model and kind of make plans for where the wall could have gone there. And in a strange way, that kind of forum does what I would finally consider is a horrible thing. It makes the Palestinians, the victims of that wall, partake in the design of their own instrument of dispossession, right? So this is a kind of a reflection on the idea of participation. Also, in order to make the points, and the transcript are provided in my book, but you could see them later, or you can read them there, they had to adopt military language. So you have human rights people speaking about rangers and about ballistics and about all sort of things in order somehow to make the points. This is our Chief Justice Barak studying one of the details of the wall. Something has been gained, a few hundred meters. But by being gained, I think a lot has been lost. I think that is one of the more tragic examples of forensic architecture, where that kind of elasticity of the wall led to its justification. It allowed the process that happened in Jerusalem, allowed Israel to argue in The Hague, in a simultaneous court, that its own legal system is adequate to deal with it. But it's also a reflection on a very banal and mundane process of participation. All the architects here would be very familiar with images like that, you know, people, non-professional, like looking, pointing at model, arguing about it. And I think that that story reflects on the most kind of extreme moment of participation. How am I doing with time? I still have 10 minutes. Okay, great. Another example of political action along the wall is to do with another form of action that perhaps I would be more supportive of. And this is a Friday protest of both Israeli, binational protests, Israelis and Palestinians along the wall protesting and sometimes shaking that element and confronting the Israeli military. The family of Bassem Abu Rahma, who tragically died during that process, have asked us to undertake an analysis as to who has killed him during that process. So now we are looking at another feature. I will show you soon a film that is maybe hard to watch. Another feature of forensic architecture, its ability to harvest from activist videos spatial information. You know that every time you go with your camera and you film an event, you also hoover in a lot of spatial data. If you have more than one camera, you can build a space around it. So this is a demonstration of an investigation we've done in this context. So three cameras, you can see the same event. We sync them up, the cameras of that event. And later we analyze it. So you see the soldiers on one side, on the left-hand side image. And they're shooting gas canisters directly at the, not in sort of ballistic, but, and hitting Bassam here in his chest in direct hit. In a sense, the question was incredibly important for the family of Bassam to establish the reason for his killing. And we have analyzed very carefully and kind of built a 3D environment by placing the cameras dynamically within space. So you would see the location of a camera at any particular moment within that. And even in one of the frames, we identified the path of the cartridge, constructed the entire space around it, and led to the prosecution of that soldier for the killing of Abu Rahman. Another, perhaps just to finish, if I may, have another 5 minute, a project that I've undertaken not in the context of forensic architecture, but it can show the, you know, the kind of the idea of the forum in a much wider context. And that is a project that I undertook with an architectural studio that I co-run with Sandy Hilal and Alessandro Petty in Betzachor. It's called Dar, that you've presented it. And a kind of commission by the Palestinian authority to look at the remains of the building or the kind of the unfinished ruins of the Palestinian parliament building in Abu Dis. Abu Dis is, of course, outside of the Israeli-designated borders of Jerusalem and the closest point in the West Bank to the Old City, to Al-Aqsa. So it was chosen by the Palestinian Authority upon their return in the 90s to Palestine to build the parliament building in. So they built the parliament building right on the line, or where they thought the line was, the border of Jerusalem. It was not otherwise marked. And they built it right against the line, demonstrating that they are as close to Jerusalem as they could. Of course, in the middle of construction, the Intifada broke. I mean, the story of that building is hilarious. It's been designed initially by a Japanese architect, in Kyoto, later developed by a Jordanian architect as a kind of fantasy image of what Jerusalem could look like from a place as far as that, but never constructed because the Intifada began and Israel built the wall right through it so that it is inaccessible. Now it is kind of annexed to the Palestinian University of Al-Quds in Abu Dis. We wanted to look, in fact, at the lines themselves. Where exactly is that line that is the border between the annexed part of Jerusalem and the West Bank? There are many such lines. It's not really where the wall is built. The wall is built further in. And there's very many versions of where that line, in fact, is. We hired a Palestinian cartographer, in fact, a kind of a measurer, person that does 5 minutes, yeah? That does those measuring. And we discovered a cartographic mistake. You know, of course, you know, this region is only mistakes. The building was not, in fact, built next to the line, but the lines cut through the building, right? So we have the building standing, in fact, in two territories, in what is Israel considers as Israel, and in the West Bank. But then another space emerged, and that was the thickness of the line itself. Of course, in when Dayan and Abdallah drew the line, the ceasefire line, they met, it's a very famous story told by Meron Benvenisti. They came on with two jeeps onto one of the hills. They put a map on the bonnet, I think, of the Range Rover of Abdallah. You know? Dayan came with an American jeep, no? And the engine was still hot. So as they were drawing the line with a grease pencil, it kind of melted a bit thicker where it was hotter and a bit thinner when the bonnet was cold. Right, so the thickness of the line itself, of course, when you're in war, everybody claims for it and becomes kind of like a disputed area. Who owns the thickness of the line? This is another line that was signed later, but it also has a thickness, right? 1.20 meters. So it's 1 millimeter on a map. It's 1.20 meters in reality, which is a kind of a no man's land. So we thought, that's a perfect parliament. Rather than separating the Palestinians to Gazans, those in the West Bank, those from Jerusalem, those from Lebanon, those from Syria, right? I mean, that parliament, in fact, is perfect. It's both in Israel, it's in Palestine, and it has an extraterritorial zone that refers to the Palestinian diaspora part, right? So we decided to kind of to make a, more or less kind of an art intervention out of it. We marked very, very precisely where that line go through the building. Now the building, the floor of that building is about 15 centimeters of pigeon and rat shit, sorry for the word, and we cleaned that line, that 1.20 meters, almost in kind of honor of the way in which commons are declared in the Middle East. You know that the minute that Tahrir Square was kind of became the place of the people is where people themselves cleaned it, right? So that's a kind of a way. So we also cleaned that line, or we made a drawing in bird shit. You see us here making it slowly. So that's a kind of a drawing within dirt, right? That is the thickness of the line. It goes very close to the speaker's place. And we decided to call it the Parliament in Exile. Right, that thickness of the line, and started traveling that line. We also followed it outside. We saw what it actually cuts through, you know, it's almost kind of within that thickness, it's kind of like a lexicon, a kind of a condensed, all the conditions of Palestine, you know, kind of like school buildings, private homes, football stadiums, olive orchards, nature reserve, you know, we said this is in fact all that remains, no? On this side, these Israelis already took. On the other side, you know, they are kind of accomplices in the Palestinian Authority. All that remains is that 1.20 meters, the length of the entire kind of territory. In different places, together with Sandy Hilal and Alessandro Petty from Betzahul, we have constructed that line and activated it in those different places as a kind of a site, as a kind of a forum, as a sort of a parliament in exile. We called it a common assembly rather than a parliament. I think I better stop before you kick me out of the stage. I have several other projects to show, but it's another opportunity. So you invite me again. Thank you for listening. Thank you.
Short question time. It will be short, but we have roving microphones. I'm sure at the moment you, like me, are reeling with the creativity and density of what we've heard tonight. So, but there is one hand up at the back already. Yes, thank you.
Hi, thank you for that. That was really, really interesting. I'm from an international studies humanitarian background, and the whole concept of architecture is quite new to me. In the way you're describing architecture, it's not sort of the design on paper, it's more the being of, like, physical beings that aren't, I suppose, human. Is that correct?
No, I, well, I think it's very much designed. The question is, who is the maker of architecture? And I would say that in my research, the kind of the working definition for me is that architecture is a kind of a result of a multivalent and a constantly shifting force field, right? So there's not, you know, the architect is part of that, you know, complex force field. But we are talking about a process of design, i.e. the organization of matter. Right? So the question is really if whether the relation between force and form could be undertaken in both directions, backwards and forwards in time, no?
Okay, yeah, now that makes a lot more clearer. Thank you.
Question down here, thank you.
I'm Angela. I'm a philosophy student. So when you started to talk about unlocking the forms, well, I naturally jumped to Plato. Mm-hmm. Plato believed that everything, as you would know, has a perfect form. So this seemed to me to be tying in, but I wasn't sure if I'd got hold of the right end of the stick with yours. So my question is, would you say that yes, you are following in Plato's footsteps? And my second question is that if you are, therefore, does that mean that Plato was the first forensic architecture?
Yes, I'd absolutely. Now, I'd say that rather than looking at perfect form, what is interesting for me is variations, right? So when you look at something like where we started, the pyramids of Gaza, right? They would be perfect Giza pyramids, right? And if they were, they would be of no interest for me. For me, it is interesting to look exactly at where I could see something more, a variation in this imperfection. What could it be? You know, when we architect are, or builders are putting in a slab, sometimes, you know, a lot of us smoke, you know, and we throw in a cigarette, no? We think it's in the beam or it's in the slab and we, you know, we can forget about it. This is gonna be the line of least resistance when this thing cracks. You know, the beam remembers the cigarette, right? So that is not about the kind of the perfect platonic form, but the irregularity, each one of those pyramids is slightly different. What does it tell me about, you know, about everything, about the building culture, about the quality of concrete there? How can I connect it backwards? How can I open up beyond the technical legal framework and understand history as it is registered in its minute details? Because I believe that in that detail, there is a much more complex and long history. In a certain sense, I would take Hamas lead, not that I support them, you know, heavens forbid, in the kind of ideologically or religiously, but I would say here they have it right, no? They see in the destruction here a direct line to 48. There's deep history in that destruction. It's not only the bulldozer and that. The kind of way of destruction itself, the way of construction, the materiality, the texture of the building is the entire, it holds within it the entirety of Palestinian history from 48 onward for them, right? So what does it mean? You know, it's a much more complex than a kind of a juridical forensics, no? I would say forensics is not a juridical process. So we say juridical forensic or non-juridical forensic. It's much more complex, no? To open up history and to, you know, to start with a kind of a detail and see how long you can draw the lines from it. It is the destruction of destruction. I absolutely love that concept.
Yes, in the middle. Thank you.
I was amazed by how you try to link topography, architecture, to human rights and investigation. And it's pretty important from an architecture background to have such an insight and understanding of your explanation. The questions would like to ask you is, I come from a war zone. I lived in beautiful Australia. And during traveling in the bus to the city, couldn't understand the building of Australian codes on how they build their houses. Uh-huh. Until later on, I've been practicing and understanding such ideas. Do you have kind of like, how can I put it together? Do you look into probably future, how Australia can look into providing bunkers or kind of rooms for...
Bunkers?
Because during war zone,
oh, I see.
I do believe probably housing Australia will not accommodate such type of. I'm sorry, I don't mean.
No. I think it's, you know, it's a very important question. It gives me the opportunity also to speak a little bit directly to the architects
exactly.
In this audience and to say several things. One is that I think in architecture, our habits as architects was, you know, research in architecture, and it could be research about politics, human rights, or history. You know, it's been part of architecture. But it has always been a part of a kind of a direct thread to design, right? We learn about a site, we analyze a site, we analyze its use, we analyze its history in order to make a better proposal on the site. I think that we need to think more in a more complicated way about the relationship between research and construction in architecture, or research and design. And it's not that I am against design in architecture, but I would say that, in fact, from my experience, just producing architectural research about war zone, about human rights, about that, without thinking or constructing the forum in which this information would resonate is meaningless. We need those forums, we need to kind of create political communities around those bits of evidence or that analysis, as one would say. And therefore, that is the task for me as an architect, to think and work for the creation of those forums for the future. And whether they are courts or other things, I do not know right now. And we have several ideas, and I proposed one in relation to the Palestinian Forum, right? The second thing that I would say in relation to your important question is that I think that war is an acceleration of conflicts that are anyway latent within urban environments. I think the urban condition is a condition of conflict, right? People say heterogeneity, people say convivity, and all sort of other things. It is in fact a condition of conflict. Whether it is violent or not is another question, but it's a conflict of interests between developers, communities, other, you know, multiple kind of and multi-directional conflict, and the architectural fact, or the kind of the way those forces slow into form, is a kind of an imprint of these forces. Therefore, I do not think that I provide a set of tools only to think extreme environments. I think from the laboratory of the extreme, it allows you to think space, right? In Australia, and I unfortunately, I do not know anything about the bunkers that you're referring to, etc. But I think methodologically, the understanding of that complex, never direct, never linear relation between form and the kind of network of forces that is around it is a very useful tool for architects, one. And two, understanding that pronouncing an architectural position needs and relies upon the assembly of forms. So that is, I think, is the task for architecture. I think we are probably at the end of the...
Yes. We, in theory, have reached our time. We can probably take one more question, if everyone can tolerate one more question. Thank you. Perhaps up here in the middle. Oh, sorry. Here first. Thank you.
It was a very fascinating presentation that you made, and thank you for being such an excellent storyteller as well. The line that is drawn has very definitive, clearly drawn sides on either side of the line. There are opposing sides on either sides of the line. But when you blow up the line, and it becomes a larger 1.2 meter wide terrain, who is your constituency for that line?
All right, this is, you know, I think,
yeah. Who is the constituency for the line, for the space?
I think this is an excellent question, because lines, when they're drawn, they are one-dimensional geometry, you know? But when they hit the ground, there is nothing like one dimension. You move into three dimension, and there's a space opens. And I think that in my previous work, I very much opposed the idea of the border to the idea of the frontier, a kind of a space, a wider space of interaction, of conflict, a place that produces its own and regulates its own kind of forms of interaction, some of them very, very violent and kind of frontier-like environment. I see in that line, in a 1.2, no? Exactly that kind of, in this turn from the one to the three dimension, or initially to the two dimension, a kind of an opening into a zone of meeting. It doesn't matter if it is, if you would say the frontier is, you know, 500 kilometers, I don't know how much, you know, the Australian frontier must have been. The one even like, yeah. Or, you know, half a centimeter. The fact is that there is space. The minute that there is space, it's a zone of interaction. So therefore, I think that, you know, we need to dive into the line, and in the line itself, you'll find political potential. Very practically, I would say that the problem we were working with, and in fact, we were working in our studio with groups of Palestinians, political scientists, and lawyers, who had that idea of a parliament for all Palestinians. They were protesting the idea that you know, political representation is fractured along the spaces that is imposed by the colonizer, right? And symbolically, within that space, being a kind of extraterritorial, or could be claimed for to be extraterritorial, we found a sort of a place into which you know, sort of a much wider stakeholders, Palestinians could actually find themselves represented. Again, that building is in Israel, in Palestine, and has this extraterritorial diasporic space, right? So that was the idea. Of course, this is not a practical proposition, right? You understand? Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
I think Eyal deserves a decent vote of thanks. And
thank you. Thank you.
Our Dean of Law, Professor Tomasik, is going to offer that formal vote of thanks. Thank you.
What is there to say after what has already been said? An extraordinarily illuminating evening for me, a rather boring corporate lawyer who always looks for ways of extending law and legal understanding to the wider world. And of course, as lawyers always find, the way you do this is by teaming up with other more creative people who provide more interesting insights, which allow you to be famous, even though the fame really should go to your collaborators. But the law school, can I say, is very, very pleased to be a co-sponsor of this important discussion, and to help to bring further information to light about this important project. We heard that Nelson Mandela taught us that education is the most powerful weapon to change the world, and of course that is so, as we, I'm sure, all would agree. But insofar as this evening's lecture is concerned, we might argue that legal education could well be such a powerful weapon, provided it is extended in such a way as to take advantage of other disciplines which are available and facilitative of such an approach. And of course, what is particularly attractive in this day and age in modern law schools is that modern law schools seek to be global in their focus. And I think that this particular phenomenon has a degree of globalization about it, which is enormously important. And so instead of just cross-examining, as we do very well in our various competitions between law schools, real people, cross-examining buildings, as we saw as being an example of this particular technique, is a terribly important in providing a deeper message, which perhaps has been neglected in the past. And so I feel, and I'm sure you all would share with me in the same sense of pleasure at the way in which we've been able to move a bit further from perhaps a common understanding of acceptance of buildings or whatever, without perhaps thinking too much more about this. But I think many questions have been raised, and I think we're grateful to the speaker for the enormous insights I think that he's provided, particularly in terms of this new phenomenon, which we in the law school will have to take on, forensic architecture. Obviously, it is the message that we should all be taking very seriously. So if you could please join with me once again in thanking Eyal Weizman.